You can't tell me anything about the Dendra O'Hur? Nobody said nothing about can't, he says, picking a tooth. The word is won't. Maybe Imbitu will feel different. Farewell. Yeah, see you later. Love some of the dialogue. Alright, so we're done except for Imbitu. The man in charge. Hail, Imbitu. At first glance, it would be easy to assume that this man is dying of some wasting disease or starvation. He is little more than a too tall skeleton wrapped in translucent flesh and a tattered robe. His hands are essentially bony claws. And yet he beams at you, his sunken eyes glittering with suppressed laughter and feverish life. Tread carefully, dear, Calistes murmurs. Imbitu is friendly enough, but he's also intelligent. Frighteningly so. Do not try to lie to him. Imbitu smiles. His teeth are a muddy brown. I know you. So many eyes have lingered on that tattoo, that noble brow. He reaches for your forehead with a shivering skeletal finger. Hell no, I'm pulling away. Silver Tide. You step out of his reach. He blinks, then smiles. I'm very sorry. I rarely deal with the living. Corpses are not quite so bashful. He flaps his hands at you. I remember you now, of course. Old Sarissa once saw you out of the corner of her eye a week before his accident. Alurimar sold you a small bag of... He breathes, closing his eyes. Sugar-dusted almonds. But those aren't the only two. No, you drift through countless lives, altering and ending them, never leaving a name. Oh, I can't stand mysteries. Love them, but can't stand them. Who are you? I'm not the woman you think I am. That was someone else. Indigo Tide. And that's it. Okay. That was the second one. The same face. The same tattoo. But yes, different eyes. Perhaps you have a secret twin. He coughs gently against the back of his hand. So, what brings you to the chapel of Dendra O'Hur? And he thinks, so she returns. Cast off. What happened this time, I wonder? Tell me about your cult. We worship the great Queen Sarlovan, Lady of Maggots, Goddess of Entropy, and Guardian of the Empty Barrier. He says, then pauses, tapping a muddy tooth thoughtfully, although worship is the wrong word, perhaps. He points to the altar nearby. It displays a skull with flat, unforgiving eyes buried in its hollow sockets. She waits on the other side of death with her billions of squirming children. They devour whatever passes into their realm, and rightfully so. Everyone must eat. His eyes twinkle fondly, but whatever she and her children eat is lost forever. And so the Dendra O'Hur work to preserve the minds and the mysteries of mortals before death claims them. We hold their shrill little thoughts in our minds and let them tumble around as they will. Whew, it feels marvelous. Tell me about yourself. Oh, there isn't much to tell. I've spent most of my years in this little chapel, he says, casting a fond look around. The Dendra O'Hur has rather consumed my life. He thinks, ha, consumed my... I'll have to remember that one. Why did you join the Dendra O'Hur? Well, that is a good question. A very good question. I congratulate you on asking it. He rubs his hands together with a papery sound. I cannot tell you much. Outsiders rarely understand what calls us to the Dendra O'Hur, but you have kind eyes, and so I will tell you that it was kindness. Beyond that, however, I cannot answer. My apologies. Tell me more. And I would love to tell you, he says, and it is clear that he would. But the full answer is rather tangled in the mysteries of our order. I simply cannot indulge you. Again, my apologies. On to more interesting topics than an old man's past, he says, flashing a stained grin. Lovely. All right, by the Dendra O'Hur. Lovely. This may surprise you, but we rarely get curious visitors. Most people seem quite nervous about us. He wets his cracked lips and awaits your questions with polite interest. Purpose. You preserve the knowledge and memories, even the consciousness of mortals, before they pass into the realm of the great Queen Sarlevan and are lost forever. What does your cult's name mean, anyway? The old man's eyes dart from side to side, and he leans in. Nobody knows, he whispers, delighted. It's a mystery. Isn't that wonderful? Huh. How long have the Dendra O'Hur existed? Centuries, he declares, though how many I couldn't say. We aren't devoted to paper records, as you might imagine. We prefer keeping them in our heads. He runs his tongue along the edge of his rotting teeth. Also, and this is slightly embarrassing, none of us managed to eat our founder. He simply disappeared one day. Can you imagine? Speaking of whom founded your cult? A man named Melmoth Levyarm. I do wish one of us had managed to eat him. Melmoth Levyarm, he says with a grand gesture. Lovely name, isn't it? Just lovely. How do you preserve humanity's knowledge? Oh, I thought everyone knew that, he says, surprised. We eat the flesh and organs of corpses to assimilate their minds, then... He trails off, noticing your expression. What? I was more interested in the process than your methods. Silver or blue? For knowledge, right? Ah, a fellow Skarlark. Well, it's quite simple and impossibly complex at the same time. He points to the various hoses and chambers adorning his robes. We do not chew on the corpses, of course. That would be quite messy. And lethal, most likely. Humans are a diseased bunch. Our suits liquefy dead flesh, extracting the information contained within. When we feed upon this, enriched flesh, it becomes part of us. Oh, really? At any rate, we scour the streets for bodies, left unclaimed. We bring them here and lay them upon the biers. His sweeping hand directs your attention to the still shrouded figures lying about this chamber. When a body is ripe with unplucked secrets, we gather about it and taste it together. Let a lifetime of thoughts flit around ours like little fish. He smacks his lips happily. Interesting. Oh, it is. And dangerous, of course. It does drive us all the slightest bit mad. He purses his lips like he's given away a naughty secret. But it's worth it, even so. We eat corpses to assimilate their accumulated memories, their knowledge, and even their consciousness. Oh, he says, clearly disappointed. Very well. Doesn't want to talk about anything else. I think we investigate all that. Yeah. So he's happy not to talk about himself, but he's reluctant to talk about anything other than Dendra O'Hur. I'm helping Folsom investigate some trouble in the underbelly. Can I ask you some questions? I don't think there's enough left for you to eat, by the way. Sorry to disappoint you. Of course. And do tell Folsom hello from me. We are dear friends. He raises a finger. Well, he frowns more than I smile, but we do have a grand time whenever we meet, which is often. One of Folsom's protégés was murdered. Do you know anything about it? Not a thing, he says, then grins. Why, am I a suspect? Maybe. Keeping your own counsel, he says, nodding sagely. Very wise. Very, very wise. Are you sure you don't know anything about the murder of Folsom's protégé? I don't. I wish I did. Even in the best of times, Folsom is such a surly dinner companion. I can only imagine his mood now. I'd like to question your acolytes. Would that be all right? Can't allow it, I'm afraid, he says with a thin smile. Not without reason. They're young and easily distracted from the path I've laboriously carved before them. Perhaps another time. Farewell. Take care. Take great care. Is that a threat? I have more questions about the trouble going on in Underbelly. Investigation. A sculptor told me that your people may have found a man killed by a strange creature. Yes, I believe I know the poor man. Dry as a leaf. Hollow as an eggshell. Barely any mind left in there at all. Inspect him at your leisure. He's the one with the charred skin on his brow. Right, the one we didn't interact with.
I'll remember that.
Now, I don't know much more about him, though I can assure you we plumbed the depths of his mind and body for answers. But I seem to recall seeing him before, possibly not through my eyes, mind you, in Cliff's Edge. He was coming out of a building near the chirurgical parlor. Okay. So we can't... He's not gonna... What if we just ask them anyway? I don't know if we can.
Go.
Maybe she's behind the murder. Yeah, we gotta interact over here.
All right.
A strong aroma of charred flesh rises from the dingy cloth over this corpse. Lift the shroud.
I'll remember that.
You carefully move the shroud to the side. There's no way around it. This dead man was a cast-off, and it would be hard for him to be deader. His flesh is papery, desiccated. His tattoo, or rather the charred remains of it, has burned through his skin and into the bone beneath. And of course there is the matter of his charred eye sockets and his horrified, gaping mouth. Parts of the corpse are missing, remnants of an aborted Dendra feast. You aren't surprised they stopped. Again, your eyes are drawn to the remnants of the cast-off's tattoo. It looks like it burst into flame when he died, burning right through his skin into the skull beneath. Touch it. It hurt me and gave me experience. The last thing you remember before your fingertip grazes that tattoo is a rising buzz. Time stutters and breaks. Panting softly, you awaken, leaning against a bier for support. Your arm burns, your temples throb, and white static claws at the corners of your vision. Someone was screaming in that lightless, timeless void. You remember that much. But it wasn't you. None of the Dendra are looking your way. So we gained 2 XP and took 2 damage. And we got a little damage from different places. Second time we lost 2 damage. Examine again? No. That's it? Alright. Can we ask him anything about it? Ah, welcome back. I see you are still on your feet. You notice he seems disappointed about this, despite his feverish cheer. Okay. What do we have? Stuff. Foreman's brood. The crippled foreman wants to transfer its life force into tiny metallic children that it has built. So far, it's been unable to transfer sufficient power, so it asks for my help. If the power transfer succeeds, the children will live, but the crippled foreman will die. I'll need to bypass the safety measures that prevent the crippled foreman from transferring energy above a certain threshold. It's suggested that I speak to its assistant, Tarnish, who might have some ideas. Alternately, there might be some other way to resolve this situation. Someone at the Order of Truth might be able to provide some assistance. Tarnish, a human worker and friend to the crippled foreman, admitted that he doesn't want the foreman to give up its life. Maybe I can use this fact to change the foreman's mind. Tarnish has given me some additional insight into the workings of the foreman's body. I may be able to transfer the energy myself, but it won't be easy. The Sorrow's Prey. Oh, this... I didn't recall that. This is good. So Zayofi, the sculptor, way back near the beginning, witnessed the murder of a man by the Sorrow, the same creature that is hunting me. Now he's obsessed with sculpting the moment of the killing, but all his attempts have been failures. He cannot immortalize the victim until he learns more about him. Zayofi told me that the victim's body was taken away by the Dendra O'Hur, probably to their chapel in the underbelly. I found the victim's corpse on a bier in the Dendra O'Hur chapel. He bore a familiar-looking tattoo that has been scorched away, suggesting that he was a cast-off like me. Perhaps one of the Dendra O'Hur can tell me more about him. Oh, so we're going to ask him again? The leader of the Dendra O'Hur informed me that the Sorrow's victim lived in Cliff's Edge. His house was near the chirurgical parlor. Perhaps a clue to his identity can be found there. Okay, so I think this is done, maybe? Let's just ask everyone again. Yeah, I don't think anyone's going to tell me anything more. Now...
Naturally.
Before I sign off here, which I guess is going to turn out to be 3 episodes... I'm going to go check with that foreman again. Now that said, maybe we can change its mind. I want to do what it wishes, I mean, but if I can change its mind, that'd be cool.
Here I come.
Yes, talking to constructs. Raise the engines. Whoops, whoops. Okay, really sensitive here. The foreman's pupils fix on you. One of them is guttering like a candle flame. You have returned. What do you wish to discuss? Yeah, persuasion. Your assistant Tarnish doesn't want you to die. If you're gone, he'll have no one. Can't you find some other way to have children?
I'll remember that.
You hear a faint rhythmic clanking as though a gear has come loose in a distant ancient clock. He has served me more than well, the construct says at last, but softly, and he is not young. A sigh rattles from the mesh around its eyes. Perhaps I will wait, run more tests. I have nothing but time. And we just gained 25 experience. Kellerstee says, that was well handled, dear. This construct will serve the world far better with its knowledge than it ever could with its idiot spawn. Hey. You're rough there, aren't you?
Yes, now.
What will you do now that you've decided to live on? Hot air sighs from the foreman's vents. Study the deaths of my children so that I will not fail in the future, it says, so softly that you barely hear it. Count the minutes until I can try again. Study my failures and mourn. Alright, let's talk to, this guy. Tarnish. He clasps your hand in his cold ones. Or hands, rather. Thank you for convincing my master not to go through with it, he whispers. He won't let this go, of course, and maybe there ain't a way to give his children life without killing him, but maybe this will keep him from doing it until long after I'm gone. Huh. Alright. Mm. Huh. I guess we could still attempt to recruit some of these others who wouldn't join, like Lido. I mean, it's in progress, not done. Kia Tawa, a member of the Dendra O'Hur, is one of the affected women. I guess I just need to find them all and then I do something? I still have to convince her to join the party, I guess? Huh. I thought these things were done. The books, yeah. So looking for that murderer. The hair comb. I'm not sure if that's really her madness that does it. Maybe he is really her enemy. I'm just going on the words of people, so... If I don't find this Persea, I'll return the comb, but I'm going to try to find her first, see if I come across her. In my explorations. I don't want to do that. Yeah, I want to, help with that. I need the backing of someone influential for that. This Reef of Fallen Worlds, it's coming up probably. His house was near the Chirurgical Parlor. Where's the Chirurgical Parlor again? Hold on a second. Is that Caravanserai? Or Cliff's Edge?
Just those two?
Alright, Cliff's Edge. Let's just see if we can find this house. And then we might call it an episode.
Fine.
Didn't seem very happy about that. By the Chirurgical Parlor. This?
Go. On it.
The salty air only partially mutes the cloud of putrid sweetness clinging to this jumble of fallen wood, stone, and iron. Until recently, this was someone's home, but the unstable ground must have caused it to collapse. Search for clues. You shift aside broken pieces of furniture and small pieces of rubble, but you find nothing of value. After a short while, you realize what has happened. Someone has already picked through the ruins and taken the more accessible valuables. You stand back, concentrating. Nothing about the pile of stone is familiar, but the view from where the door once stood, a boundless horizon falling into the sea, is. This appears to be the house where the cast-off once lived, or... Either he left no clues to his identity, or they were taken by the scavengers. It might be helpful to ask around the area and see if anyone spotted anyone looting this house. Search for anything of interest. You rummage through the dusty piles of stone and wood looking for anything interesting, but no, these ruins appear to have been picked clean. Study the horizon. Anamnesis. Fingers of wind rake at your face. You squint into the sunlight, trying to remember. You've stood here before. You know you have. Letting your thoughts untangle. The skyline tilts, and you stagger as the memory engulfs you. You grip the edge of the crude banister, grimacing at the sea. The calm of the scene no longer touches you as it once did, nor, you realize, does this body. You smile at your own impatience. Your restlessness must rival the ocean itself.
I'll remember that.
A gust of salty air bears the memory away in ribbons, leaving your mind aching and dry atop the ruins of the house. There is little doubt now. The changing god and the cast-off killed by the sorrow once lived here. Okay, let's try might to dig through the pile to find the source of the stench. Success! The smell intensifies as you heave a side of slab of ceiling. A swarm of startled insects spins away into the air, revealing the body of a young woman, torn and crushed. An invisible hand rips the air from your chest and a strength from your legs. You fall, feeling a presence close around you, a heat on your back. Who's there? Your words are a whisper. You can barely breathe now, and the heat fills you like a fever. Suddenly, a cool hand covers your burning eyes. A smooth arm folds over your stomach. The hell?
Making a note.
And just like that, the heat is gone. You whirl around. No one is there, but you sense something has changed in the labyrinth. Really? A new reflection is forming in the labyrinth. What? This? Or what labyrinth? This doesn't seem like a labyrinth.
Yes, now.
The corpse of the young woman lies undisturbed among the ruins of the house that became her cairn. You find nothing. The previous looters did their job well. What the hell happened? I don't suppose anyone can tell me what happened.
Yes.
Yes, lass?
Look like these changed. Okay. So next episode we will look around. Ask people about what they've seen. Find a way to communicate with the shadowy reflection that has appeared in the labyrinth. When I discovered the body of a young woman in the ruined house, a new reflection began to take shape in my mind. In order to interact with it, I'll need to form a stronger connection. Scavengers picked the cast-off's house clean. Someone near the house might be able to tell me if they spotted anyone digging through the rubble. So next episode we'll be asking people about that. And, see what we can find out. Thanks so much for watching, guys. See you next time, and endure. In enduring, grow strong.